So you must be wondering what this lady is going to talk about, security. So let me start from where this all started for me. I have been working, this is like way back in 2000, when I was working with a multinational company, and then we were releasing a product which had an $100 million revenue at that time. Interesting, we had just shipped the product, and after a lot of late nights, had great fun, shipped. We just settled down and we were still partying, in fact. And then one of our customers called up and said there was a nasty bug. Nasty bug was bad during those days because that was the pre-cloud era. We used to ship products in CDs, burn them into CDs, put them into red boxes and ship them out. Now that, I was in the San Jose office where we had hundreds of boxes returning back because of one nasty bug that we had left into the code. And it was almost a humiliating experience to sit as an architect and see hundreds of boxes getting returned from channel partners, from our distribution specialists, from our vendors, just because there was one single security bug. That's where I started being a little more passionate about fixing bugs, fixing security bugs, trying to find it, fix it much earlier than where it started. By the way, that bug was a fairly simple one. It was in some random error condition that we were throwing up the admin password in clear text, which was not so great, but yeah, but it was nasty beyond words because we had to recall CDs during those days. So that's where I've been almost a decade or more, primarily around security reviews. I'm an ethical hacker. Been around security for a long time, but that's what got me started really. Okay, so let me just get started with why would any of us move into a house that does not have doors or windows? We won't. We need all the doors done, all the windows done, all the last latch, all the last lock done. Before that, we wouldn't enter into the house. Forget occupying it. Even if there is one bolt that's missing, we'll say, no, this has to be fixed. That's where all of us are, right? But reality is here. 60% of code that's there on the web, that's alive today, is almost like a house without a door or a window. Why? The house is actually open to vulnerabilities around the neighborhood. You can have only burglars around your neighborhood come and attack your house, pretty much. There is nobody else who will come. But code that is on the web is pretty much open to the entire world. But then we take the least chance with respect. Most chance with respect to that and say, yeah, you know, let me put functionality, let me get it working, let something go wrong, then I'll figure out what to do with it. Hardly any time that we say, no, let me fix it before it goes. And 60% of code is functionality. Maybe there is time pressure, there's functionality, there's competition, whatever. But most of us ship code that's functional and not really closed, secure. So the focus of my talk today will be about how to make jQuery code a little more secure as we write it. Okay, so the agenda of this meeting will be common errors that we as engineers, we as developers do. It's not to talk about bugs that are in the jQuery code, vulnerabilities that are seen in the jQuery code today. I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about bugs that we make as engineers. We all make mistakes. I'm going to take some very popular examples and then explain what the problems are around it. I will talk about how to overcome some of those bugs and then the tools around it. Anytime, feel free to stop me, ask me questions, or we could do it at the end of it. Yes, most of it would be, I would take very popular examples so that you can relate to what I'm talking. Okay. One big thing that we have to remember is hackers always work around barriers. No, most hackers will not go and break your barrier and say, oh, I've broken this for you. That happens hardly once in a way where, you know, you hear some government website hacked and then he says, oh, I hacked it. Most hackers don't do all this. They just keep walking around nicely, safely, never realizing, never using your gate that you've put, keep using it. You never realize that it's been used for like a period of time before you knew it was used like that. So very few hackers go back, bring down the website and say, oh, I did it for you. Most people just work at the background without you realizing what is it. So hackers work around. They never come to the fore and say, okay, here's what I did. Okay, so let's get started. I would not go through all the problems, all the security, possible security risks, bugs that we could. I would take a few of them, explain them in depth, go over what are the possible examples, scenarios, how to fix them. We could take others maybe offline. One thing that we have been talking even in the previous session is there are thousands of scripts that are readily available. That's reality today. All of us as engineers feel very nice when we have to say put some slider. Oh, we go search, Google search, there's something, throw it in. That's the greatest thing we can do, and then oh, slider comes up. Next, like you need a login dialog, there is some authentication you need, something comes up, you're done. This, somebody was saying about this, you know, Stack Overflow based development, like we also do Google based development. Search, you get it, pull it in, yeah, it almost works there. Now what happens, it's nice, quick development, great, all of us are doing nice. What's the problem? Now let me take a very popular example of a timer JavaScript. Apparently this was a JavaScript that was a timer that was used, that was very popular. This script was used by a lot of engineers like us who used to, you know, generally pull in code to work. Now look at what happened in the script. Is that the site that was using the script suddenly got blocked by Google. So the guy who was hosting the site had no clue about what was happening to his code. Why did he get blocked? His code seems right, but he was using this timer. Now what is wrong with this code? I'm not sure if it's readable. Is this, look at what was hacked, and it was pointing to a malicious website. And even more interesting part of the code is this. This if statement compiles to true only on IE. So you look at what happened, there is somebody who's introduced a malicious code inside into a JavaScript, and then he's also put some if condition which executes only for a Internet Explorer scenario. Now this was a problem obviously, which like most of us when you are taking a plugin looks nice for us to start working with it. So that was just an example to say what could go wrong. Yes? Yeah, it used to break on all IEs apparently. Okay, so what can go wrong when you pull in plugins like this? The plugin site is down, which is like, you know, most of us developers are like, oh, you know, today I wrote something great, I want to share it with the world, I share it. After some time, I lose interest. My site is down. You don't know, you know, you are left in a lurch because of me. Second, is this whole compatibility issue which like, you know, we all are, you know, swimming against pretty much. You know, you do something, there is some other compatibility, something goes wrong and then goes down. And there is, most often developers are not committed to keeping it for lifetime. I mean, it's just a fancy hobby that, you know, oh, I just created something new, like I feel like putting it on the web, I put it. But then, am I committed to it for the next 5 years? No. Am I going to keep it alive and then fix bugs over it? Almost not. But then we as people who are consuming it assume it's forever most of the time, and that causes huge problems. Now the worst form is really this. The plugin site gets attacked, code gets injected, and then your site is down. Pretty much, you know, your site is now spreading the malicious code out, because the guy who started it is no more interested really in the site that he's hosting. So you want your site to be secure, pretty much you don't use any third party hosted libraries unless you're 100% sure. 100% sure that he's going to keep it alive, he's going to keep it updated, he holds security higher than you, because you are using him as a library there. Okay? So you cannot assume that it's going to be as much as what you want. In case you are using it directly, which I would strongly recommend, don't do it. Use some tools to verify it, which I'll go over. Except for Google CDN, general thumb rule is don't do it. It's not worth it, worth the effort, you're just getting into trouble. The next problem that I would talk about is URL encoding. URL encoding is an interesting thing, because okay, we know HTTP URLs need to be encoded because there are alphanumeric characters, there are special characters, you need to encode, you need to escape, great things, we all know it. Unicode character support came in because multiple languages needed, all that, everything came in, protects us from cross-site scripting, great so far. What does URL encoding get us into as trouble? You can really abuse the encoding mechanism to the extent that you could. You could basically escape encoding with like special characters to create a URL which could cause damage to you. I'll go to a very specific example. The bigger problem is that client and server start interpreting these as valid requests as long as they are not able to figure out that it's an encoded or an escaped URL with you. And most often hackers disguise URLs, use encoding to disguise rather than to encode really. So you are into trouble as it starts. Okay. Now one very popular example that's a little old but is interesting. You see this? This was the code red worm. It was a URL encoding problem. Nothing seems wrong. Look at this part of the thing. It was an assembly shell encoded in 16-bit sequence using an URL encoding. Using Unicode encoding. It was an assembly shell sequence that got encoded. And what did it do? It was simple. %1990 translated to two NOOPs, which basically translated to two NOOPs on an x86. And apparently there were 12,000 IAS servers that went down over this one hack. The estimated damage was 500 million. Over a simple %1990 that went out. There was nothing too complicated in it actually. Okay? So you see real world, pretty much the things that you don't look for is what somebody hacks at. It may not be something that you can apparently see and say, oh, nobody's going to do it. Never happens, which is why that whole window example comes back. People are waiting to see which door can be opened. And that's reality. Okay, solutions, simple. Avoid using get method to submit data. That I will explain a little more in detail, but avoid it to submit data because that can cause you more URL encoding problems than like normal. Don't ever rely on client-side validation. Client-side validation is pretty much hackable the other side. So there's nothing that you can securely keep yourself saying, oh, there is client validation, there is this that I've done, no use. On the server, importantly, it's a fail. Any input that does not pass is a fail. A default data processing should never be a pass. Any data that you ever get should be a fail unless it passes certain things. It can't be, okay, I'll pass it down and then check for error conditions. You fail it, you don't pass it always. Understand how the RFC syntax for the URL validation, URL encoding is. There is, RFC clearly mentions how to do it. You'll have to, you know, figure out how it does. And remember, different web servers have different things that they, you know, support, don't support, and things like that, which is going to, you know, vary. Example, the percentage U by IIS. So URL encoding, in summary, is basically hackers can escape Unicode characters, escape, use a set of sequence of characters to disguise what has been sent to you. Unless you are careful over what is being received at the server, you are not going to be able to manage what has come. So always do your security check after the data is decoded. Don't do the security check and then decode data. Because once you decode your data, you really don't know what has gone wrong before that. So this code red worm is a great example of seemingly simple sequence which went wrong. Okay? The next problem that I'll talk about is cross-site scripting. This is a famous one. Cross-site scripting over years has caused more than 18% of all web hacks today. Cross-site scripting works dramatically simply actually. Somebody sends you a link to your own bank and says, okay, sbi.com/something. You think, unless you see the person who sent it, you are going to click it, which is easy. User, now you as the user, now sends out this script onto sbi.com because you go send it there. Now that's so far good because you haven't realized from whom the mail came in the first place. Now the script is returned, executed on your browser. Now what happens? The script has now captured cookies of your session DOM. And that's where he's able to steal your data. Now the sequence started with you doing a simple thing of taking a mail from somebody and then just clicking on it. But that's reality. You are going to continue having hackers who are going to continue sending out mails like this, spammers saying, oh, you know, you have won 1 million tomorrow. All this, we all keep seeing these mails. It's not anything new. So how do you as the web server protect yourself and also your users? That's the focus of this. So cross-site scripting is the second largest way to hack after SQL injection. Okay, so basically cross-site scripting, there are like three different ways that people do cross-site scripting. One is a persistent cross-site scripting, where what you do is, suppose you have these forums, you have wiki pages, you put a script there and wait for somebody to click it. So the script is already thrown into your website, and then somebody is clicking it, and then, you know, then the process starts. Then this whole session, cookie, everything starts from there. So the first is persistent, where it's basically already thrown into your website. It's thrown there and then you start. Reflected one is more where you are not, it's not thrown into your website, but it's more of data that is given as input. Let's say I'm taking a username and password. As a part of that input, he hacks it in. From there you are now again getting into trouble because from there like the script starts executing into it. DOM based accesses is the most dangerous one because at this point the server is not even in picture. The client sees a web page, your user sees their web page, he assumes everything is right. He has no clue that something is already wrong. Somebody has injected something, it is showing something that he should not see in the first place. So there is no way to protect against the DOM based accesses from the server. There is really no, you'll have to protect how you write code rather than say, oh no, I will go and save it the other side. What can a hacker accomplish? Most hackers look for cookies. Cookies of sessions of your bank, sessions of your social network logins, sessions of anything. Basically session IDs, session data is what is the most interesting data mostly for hackers. They use that and then transfer it back again as an authenticated session. Because the session is now authenticated, you read the cookie, you have an authenticated session, you are ready to go. Key logging is the next one, where your key sequences are now getting stored. Where your what you type is start getting stored, and then you know he starts replaying it when he wants. So what hackers specifically do as they start off is wait for you to bite it. Most often people wait for you to bite it and then see, okay. See, most of these reflected accesses or like DOM based accesses needs social engineering. That is, you just throw out it and wait for somebody to click it, wait for something to happen. Wait for somebody to have logged into sbi.com and still come back to your website. That's when like the session is alive. And that's when you start getting data about all this. So that's more of, you know, what they wait and watch this whole thing. And you'll have to be, you as web developers need to be extremely careful over some of this. I'll just go over this DOM based accesses a little more because it's more interesting from the way it starts. Look at what the attacker did. He sent out and said, check out this. See, the attacker server is this, website is your website. He sent out and said, check out this. He's done nothing really wrong. He sent you website/search. Website is your website, which you always trust, which could be facebook.com, sbi.com, which you always trust. You don't really worry about the site. He had a keyword of a script. The keyword where he sent the malicious code is the script. What happened? You harmlessly clicked it. your end user clicked it, went back to the server, server no clue, server assumes you are the person. Now the server has no clue that it's already injected in. He thinks your app is asking it, he returns back the data. Now look at what happened. He got it back and now data is already into the script. The script now sends back the cookie information back to the attacker server. Now the sequence of what happened without the server having any clue of how he actually sent out information is very interesting, because of the whole way that you can do DOM manipulations at runtime really. That's the real problem in this whole thing. Okay, so going to solutions on this, I'll give, you know, these are basically thumb rules that, you know, people keep saying, because there have been like enough of study over excesses being the worst form of attacks for us. Don't ever set inner HTML or dot inner HTML directly. Don't. It puts you open to more attacks. Use set inner text. Avoid APIs that can turn, you know, strings to code, like your set interval, set timeout. These are, you know, which can just turn it and then you are back to trouble. Use strict content policy. I will talk about this a little more. Untrusted data should never be mixed with your HTML content. Untrusted data, your data, don't mix these two together. You mix these two together, end user doesn't know, your server doesn't know, you're just, you know, blinded by the whole thing. Untrusted data is, let's say you're taking an input. You have not encoded, validated, decoded the input. Don't use that input to now create a run, like to create a runtime HTML, runtime JSP. Don't do it. Yes, you shouldn't, you can take it from a form, but then if you're putting it back to the user, don't do it.
Like a Facebook comment.
Yes, like a Facebook comment. It's like a great example. I'll just go over some of these random ones in some time. One other thing that you can do, which as security experts, people recommend you to do, is that start encoding output. There is this tool called jQuery, which you can use, which protects against most of these DOM-based attacks. You can do it, and then it will at least encode the output so that you are safe with respect to scripts that you have. Okay, this is an even more interesting security risk: cross-site request forgery. This is one of you would see this in different forms. It's called session hijacking, click jacking, hostile linking. It's called with various forms. And the bad news about CSRF is that it can happen when your session is over HTTPS and you have a valid session. This is an interesting one, because what happens is you log into a bank. You keep that on one tab. You go and see some random site, which says, oh, you know, click here when you see a dancing cat. We all see these random ones, right? Go click it. What happens there? He's taken this session ID and then started working with it. I don't know if this is readable. See what happened there. It's an image there where the source has started now. He started using your bank ID, your bank transactions DOM. Is that readable? It isn't. But the bank is now validating the session, because he thinks it's a valid session which he created in the first place. So he's going to say it's fine and then continue doing it. So there is no way to protect unless you write ways to stop forgery right when the person is trying to do it. Because most often you can't expect end users to say, oh, when you're using bank transactions, don't go and click any other page. None of us are going to listen to all this. So it's better to protect upfront. This was an interesting problem that happened last year. It was a very well broadcasted CSRF that happened. LinkedIn last May, LinkedIn had a simple CSRF attack where anybody could delete any other user's recommendation. It was a simple one from what it seemed. How? If you look at the code, when you see today on LinkedIn, you can see anybody's recommendation to anybody as long as it's public. Look at what happened. So the source code already had the user ID there. You see that user ID that I put up there, it's there. When you give a recommendation, here is the link that you get. That's the link that you get. Look at what LinkedIn did. Now to withdraw a recommendation, he did nothing much except changing the DEP to WDR. That's all he did. So far, good. Now what could somebody do with it? Simple. He went, took that user ID from there, and then removed recommendations of him. I've got everything working. Sounds surprising, right? As straightforward as it looks. It looks straightforwardly surprising now. That it was such a simple attack. Anybody could have seen the URLs and then done the same thing. So get a user ID. Go to your own provide recommendation, you had a link. Just change it to WDR, change the user ID, you are done. This happened last May. LinkedIn fixed it almost immediately as soon as the vulnerability was reported. But that's how real life is. You think it's secure, it really need not be. You don't expect a CSRF attack with respect to LinkedIn. But reality is, it's code and then all of us with it. Okay, so simple solutions to CSRF. There are lot of solutions to how do you avoid CSRF. CSRF is one of those attacks which as end users are not able to understand at all. Because if you saw in the previous case, you keep one tab, you go to another tab of your browser, end user has no clue of what is going wrong. You saw the LinkedIn again, LinkedIn did something right. He just changed the WDR to change a give recommendation to a take recommendation. He didn't realize that, you know, people could go ahead and do something else. So check for the referrer header. Check the headers. Check. Okay, some browsers support origins. Check it. The other interesting thing that you can do is you can double submit cookies. What it means? Have a cookie and also a parameter which is a random value so that the server checks both and then you know, okay, it is coming from you. Or there is a different way of doing it which is also called synchronizer token pattern, where the server generates a token, sends it out to the client per session. Now the client has to send back that token for every form input that comes to it. Every form input, every URL input, like the client has to send it back. Server validates it and then knows, okay, this has come from the same client, it's not come from a different client. So you can also tag every form with a unique token. But then remember, when you tag it with a unique token, you'll have to change the tokens. See, a lot of times you assume that if you have a secret cookie, it's going to work. A secret cookie will not work because a secret cookie is what will get sent again. You do a multi-step kind of authentication, multi-step processing. Okay, I'll do this step. As long as your steps are being able to play, somebody is able to play back your steps, you are in trouble. Nothing is going to work because somebody can like replay the same sequence just like what I showed you with LinkedIn. You just need to replay the sequence in the correct order. So while people think post, secret cookies, or something like, you know, you just keep a way to, you know, multi-step process is going to work, pretty much doesn't work against CSRF. So if you see the concept, if you have to explain it very simply, add a parameter into your request. Include that token. Get your server to validate the token back. Did it receive the token or not? If it didn't receive the token, he knows he's already hacked. But how many of us do it? None of us, right? Great, thank you. Okay, so let's go to some more tips. I think these were the four broad problems that I wanted to cover because these are problems that are that can cause havoc when they are combined with each other also. I'll like talk about some of that interestingly after some time. See, URL encoding, we all encode URLs without realizing URL encoding can cause us problems. Plugins getting misused, malicious code getting infected is a huge problem. Cross-site scripting, you would read enough that's one of the first vulnerability around. CSRF is dangerous anytime it happens. So these four, you have to be careful as you are writing your code. Now let's go to content security policy. I'll just talk about what is content security policy and why do you do it. How many of us use content security policy for our code? Okay. Content security policy basically tells the client, tells the server, enforces a content security policy and says, okay, you know, it is sent along with the HTTP header. The client can enforce it after that. He sees the origin and says, okay, from this origin is all that I take. If he sees an error, he just throws up a post and says, okay, no, but there is something wrong. Now, this is interesting because you can give directives for everything, images, for your fonts, for your plugin types, for your connections, everything you can give. You can basically stop. So what happens? You have your code. If somebody injects some code into it, just like what I explained earlier, it won't work because it is referring to content outside your website. It's not going to work. So as long as you're able to lock down content to your own server, your own origin, you'll be safe. The best thing about content content security policy is that you have various parameters on which you can control it. Things like font, things like frame, things like child frame. See, a lot of us put iframes in. You can control some of this and say, you know, what can you take from which place, what can't you take from which place. So that, you know, it kind of closes door with respect to what code can be executed within your file. Now, content security directive by default is open. It's a wide open directive. You'll have to close it back. If I don't put font hyphen src equal to anything, it means it's star. It can take fonts from anywhere. I'll have to tell it where to take it from. Now, if you look at a lot of these social widgets, they will need you to allow content from, say, plus.google.com or like some of those so that, you know, he can send out this content correctly back. One of the other things to do is that I would strongly recommend not to use inline scripts. Don't use inline scripts. Inline script is a place for somebody to inject code. But if you're using an inline script, put a nouns there and then, you know, keep a content security policy which describes the exact nouns back so that your code is not getting hacked with something that is unknown. If you're not putting on nouns, you can also create a hash of the script itself back, of the entire script section, and then put it back into the content security policy. Now, content security policy also takes SHA-256 hash, so it should be okay for you. And avoid changing text into script. This I've been talking about it multiple times. Okay, this is what I was talking about. Lock down content completely. Default source is none. Script source is only you. Style source is only you. There is just no way that anybody injecting anything can ever execute something into your, within your application context. Lockdown is the best policy really, unless you can't avoid it. SSL, again, you know, we all know, use SSL, but then it doesn't help unless, you know, you are using it along with something else. Okay, so all this, yes, it doesn't happen to me, it happens to everybody else except me. We as engineers tend to say this, oh, it happens to everybody else, not my code. My code is the safest code, which is why I started with that example of myself where it was, I think, almost humiliatingly embarrassing. So that's reality. Now this is reality of what trends are. 99% of websites, according to this, have at least one vulnerability, which is pretty much all of us. And if you look at white hat data in 2013, he again says this, 86% of websites have at least one vulnerability in. And the biggest of most websites have more than one vulnerability in. In fact, the average is 55. It's not one, it's 55. Average website has 55 in it. And the first top categories that get hit are retail, education, and then it goes down. But top categories are into all these e-commerce, retail kind of websites. So while you can say, okay, it's not me, it's definitely all of us, 99% of, and most often we all know there is a problem in the code. That's where like that 30% comes. Most often people know there's a vulnerability. Vulnerabilities take long to fix. In my previous organization, we used to take anywhere between 4 to 6 months to fix a vulnerability. Customers who have deployed it, taken it, push it out, test it. In fact, the average today is 193 days to fix a vulnerability. Fix it, roll it out, ensure that nothing else is broken on the way. Most often you fix something, something else breaks on the way. So trends essentially tell us that yes, all of us are in trouble sometime. It's not that, you know, it's not my problem. Most of us tend to say, oh, it's not my problem. You know, I have deadlines to meet, I have functionality to fix, code to ship, and security comes in the end. Never works. This is even more interesting statistics of last year. Apparently, most Americans fear hacking more than even terrorism. It's interesting, right? Because we think terrorism is like the most important thing. Oh, you know, not. It's almost like double the thing. People are worried about vulnerability, hacking more than one. 30,000 websites get hacked every single day. Every single day. That's a huge number. It's not one, two, 30,000. And Google continues blacklisting a lot of websites because they are pointing to bad, malicious sites, web code sites, all that. He blocks apparently around 10,000. Now that's a lot of data. One of us will like easily fall into that data. How many of you are aware of the Sony hack that happened? Okay. So the Sony hack was interesting, right? The Sony hack, supposedly a zero-day hack. It started with some email chain. Nothing could be more damaging than personal mails, unreleased feature films, contract compensation of their senior executives went out. Nothing could have been more damaging than that. Unreleased feature films, senior executives talking about Barack Obama, to everything went out in public, into sites. And they had to get it to a point where almost for 10 to 15 days, they went back to fax and handwritten mails. They never knew what started the attack for them. They had to shut down everything, including their routers to everything, and then they started doing telephone calls and hand exchanges. That's how serious the whole situation got for them. It got out of hand totally. And it started with a mail. Obviously, it should be somebody who started with a CSRF and then went down quickly. But somebody played it safe. Somebody played it quietly over 3-4 months, pulled out the entire data, and then Sony was down on its knees. Right? Okay, so that pretty much comes to my next part of the topic. Yes, so all of us need to protect, secure code that we write. We can say it doesn't happen to me, but it happens to all of us. So let's go over what can be potential security attacks. You see, security defects that you can see, there are tons and tons of them that can happen. You can have bad authorization, you could write bad business logic, as in you just wrote bad code. There is nothing to correct it. And there is a lot of pen testing, vulnerability testing which you can do. And then there are a lot of static analyzers which you can use, static code analyzers which you can use, which could be helped. So I will talk in this session basically about static code analyzers which can help us during the development process, rather than talk about pen testing or, you know, some kind of penetration testing tools, which also would be interesting for us. Okay? This tool is interesting, retire.js. This tool's tagline is interesting. What you require, you must retire. That's pretty much whatever you think what you require, you will never retire, but you should retire it. Because there will be a better version, there will be something else which comes after it. So this tool basically, it basically looks for publicly disclosed vulnerabilities, which is very important because when you're using external libraries, it's good to keep track of what's happening with somebody else. Means what's happening with like libraries that you're using, what's happening with like things around it. So there is a way to configure it to like automatically monitor and then run there are command line, there are various ways to run the tool itself. This is a screenshot of what happens. Set it up correctly, it will tell you, it will keep checking and then tell you, okay, you know, this has some vulnerability, please, you know, look at it. So you can actually, as you start including libraries, you can put in a, put in something like this in place, so that you know, in case like the library itself is low, is now hitting vulnerability, you are aware of what's happening, rather than going the reverse way. This JS Prime is an interesting lightweight tool again, which basically parses for, you know, sources and sinks that will find common vulnerabilities. The sinks, if you're not using it right, he has a nicely sophisticated code flow analysis algorithm, which seems to be pretty good, which will identify what code path could potentially lead you into a vulnerability. Now he is, his best USP is really that he is able to, his number of false positives and false negatives are pretty low. Most code analysis, static analysis tools, like the problem is everything which doesn't seem to fit him, he's going to say it's wrong, which is really not the case with this, which seems to be pretty good actually. So you could look up at this, use this again. But my most favorite one is JSHint. JSHint is something which is a very popular static code analyzer, which you can integrate into your development environment, like your Eclipse or your Visual Studio, whatever you have. The good thing about JSHint is that you can configure it based on how you are coding, how within your team, your organization, you have coding guidelines. You say, okay, no, put braces here, do this here, declare variables. So you have a set of configuration which you can give the tool itself, saying, okay, go global scope, not true, this doesn't work, this doesn't work, so that the tool will start catching all these correctly. Okay? Yeah.
But I didn't still get how this can help products from security.
Yeah, I'm just going there. Okay, what's the output of this code? What is console log print? What does it print? Okay. What's wrong with this code now? What's wrong with this code? I can't hear. Yes, it's not declared. It's not declared. What's wrong with this code? Global scope pollution. Works? Code works. Code compiles? Works. Something is wrong with this code. JSHint finds it for you. He will actually tell you that there is a problem. This is where you start using it for variables. Look at the next example. What's wrong with this code? My editor has already marked it, so. What happened? Yes. Counter got declared again. It's telling you clearly it's defined. But if you run this code, it's going to work. There is nowhere that you're going to find this flaw at all. JSHint, I just gave you two random examples, but JSHint really captures lot of such coding errors, which you generally, it just habitually will not catch if you're just doing black box testing on it. It never catches. Lot of black box testing will say, yeah, it's fine. I mean, lot of this code is fine code actually. You can run more sophisticated code, but I gave you simple examples to say, see, it will catch you simple errors today. And that starts correcting, helping you to correct. Okay, so when do you run static analysis? Of course, as engineers, we don't have time anytime, obviously, right? Every time we are running behind deadlines which don't work. The best time to run static analysis is just at the point of integration testing. That's the best time to really run it. And if you see the cost grows exponentially as it moves off. There is, you don't catch it there, you are running into more trouble as it's getting caught later. So run static analysis as you're integrating code, helps long term to fix code correctly. Okay, quick summary. Implement security by design. This is one of my favorite lines. Means what? As you start grounds up, build it right. Security cannot be an afterthought to you. When you start, your web server runs with least privileges. Least privileges required for you. Assume that you're going to have malicious attacks. Assume that input is going to be wrong. Assume that you're going to have vulnerabilities in your libraries. Assume all this. don't assume that, oh, this doesn't happen to me. No, it happens to us. It happens to every one of us. Never trust any input or output. Never. Default has to be a fail. It cannot be a pass. Fail is what works. Pass is based on conditions. Fail is based on, fail is how it starts. Third, secure by default. Most often we have this whole crib, which I also hear with a lot of people saying, usability versus security. You start increasing security, usability goes down, obviously. But you have to get that fine balance of with respect to you, where does it draw a line? But I would recommend secure by default is much, much more important than the usability for you. Because security is down. Recently, there was an Ola cab attack, right, where like somebody went ahead and then put some few million addresses out in public. Credibility lost. There is no way to recover that and say, you know, Ola cab, maybe we should just see. Actually, what he did was simple. He just didn't take another way to authenticate the same thing. He tried to simplify it saying, oh, just take the phone number or something. It works. Prone puts you back into attack. Now it takes you a lot of time to like build that credibility back and say, oh, by the way, you know, all your credit card information is safe with me. It's never safe anymore. Who's going to trust Sony anymore? Nobody. I mean, whatever you say, you know, we are trustworthy, you are no more trustworthy. You are done. Most vulnerabilities are a combination. Never do people use CSRF or a CSS or one of them and then, you know, most attacks are a combination of attacks with a lot of social engineering in it. Social engineering is most of us stay logged into Facebook, stay logged into LinkedIn, stay logged into our bank accounts, and also go and visit some random sites just while browsing. All of us do this. Most attacks wait for some of these sequences to happen correctly. And so it will be a combination of any of these techniques to be deployed by the hacker. And at this point, hackers are going smarter than like the engineers who are writing it. If you see statistics today, 30,000 websites every day down is huge statistics for us. Use tools. Use tools effectively. Tools don't cost you much time. It feels like, oh, you know, I have to set up another tool, I have to do this, I have to do that. No, long term, huge benefit for you. It may take you 2 days to set it up, but once you've set it going, it keeps working for you. You know what's right, what's wrong. You keep doing it. Newer engineers come and fall into habit of writing correct code rather than, you know, saying, oh, you know, we'll finish all this. And then, oh, you know, there is a quality assurance team which needs security compliance. Let's just go and run some tests. Never works. Security, as you do right from the beginning, gives you much more hold on what's happening around with your code. And more importantly, stay tuned to security advisories. This SSL heartbleed was a great example of something that supposedly working for years went down. Now, if you're not keeping track of what's happening around you, you're done. I mean, you had to patch, you have to do it. Better do it as you hear it. I leave you with my favorite slide. It says, okay, when do you fix bugs? Fix bugs as soon as you see it, because bugs grow. As you leave them with you, it grows, manifests into something really big that is going to really take you a long, long time to fix. And security bugs are even more nasty than like normal bugs. So stomp it as soon as you see it. Rather than say, oh, input validation, that escape character, I will do it in the next round of testing. Oh, I'm just shipping a beta, the next time it works, I don't have a problem. Never works. It's more a practice, just like when you sleep, you lock the door, lock your windows and sleep. You never leave the door open and say, oh, by the way, you know, my area is very safe, nothing happens in my area. No, we all are very careful. We will lock the door, ensure that the door is locked and then sleep. Reality is the same. Lock it as soon as you see it. Don't keep it open and say, ah, you know, there are like 1 million websites. Who's going to come and hack me? You never know. For fun, somebody may hack. Somebody really wants data out of you. Maybe it's easy. I'm done, guys. Thank you. Questions? I take. Was it useful? Questions, comments, talk to me. I'd be rather very happy to talk to you about security. Anybody wants one-on-one, just talk to me about what you are facing. Interesting, because I've been basically doing a lot of security reviews. In my previous organization, I used to head a security review board which reviewed more than 100 product architectures, designs, implementations, including protocols, file systems, app servers, to see what could go wrong. And then invariably, we would see enough of things going wrong. So over time, you learn to, you know, start saying, okay, do this, do this, do this, do this, don't do these. So that, you know, you are at least keeping the base sanity of your code intact. Yes. Okay, sorry, I can't hear you. Yeah. Yes, yes. Yeah, same thing, right? It's simple, right? Yeah. Airtel, if you saw that entire sequence of what happened, and then what I explained today, it like explains you what happened. Airtel was using some library outside. That guy's server got hacked. Code got infected in. Now like Airtel is now disowning responsibility is now a different thing. You know, Airtel says, okay, like I'm not responsible is a different thing. But that's not fair. I mean, we as Airtel users, like, oh, what the hell? I mean, you know, how did Airtel allow a library? Must be one great engineer like, no? Like us who just included some library in, and then that code got infected. Location went out. Yes. Yeah, that's, see, reality of situation is at different points in time, you are like consumers or like suppliers. See, in this particular instance, we are like consumers, so we are like, oh, Airtel is unfair. How many times your code is broken, would you call it unfair? No, you'd say, yeah, you know, it just happened. So, you know, it's both ways. Security is basically something that most often people don't pay attention. That's real. I mean, as bad as it looks, we don't pay attention. And when it hits, we disown, saying, yeah, see, what did Airtel do? He said, oh, we just use a library from some GitHub, we don't know what happened there. That is a stance which is okay, but doesn't work. Because Airtel is today in like monopoly with us, it all works. If you're not in monopoly, it'll be even more interesting. So
in that case, we should not use the...
Yeah, when, I would rather say don't use libraries directly. Don't link their libraries directly because you never know what is the other side. Yeah, download it. Yeah, keep it with yourself, and then you know use it if you really want to use it.
Yeah, and one more question about the CSRF thing. So because last company I worked in the CSRF by using the webapp content policy level. So is it give the 100% guarantee the hackers deliver?
Okay, there is nothing that can 100% guarantee you. There's nothing today. Okay, that's if there is. See, if you see Sony hack. Till now, we have, I think, within the white hat community or the hackers community, we haven't figured out what was the sequence, what was the problem. It hasn't been figured out. People know where it started, what it ended. What was the sequence, what and all caused it? See, it's always like the hackers are like two steps ahead of you every day. And you need to stay there, keep track of what's happening. That's the max that you can do around it. If you're using others' code, as I said, pull it down to yourself. That's the safest. Pull it down to your repository, keep it with you, maintain it with you. Even if you don't understand that code, most often library, somebody else's code, you don't understand. It's easier to pull it down, keep it with you, because at least this snapshot works for you. And you know it works in your environment. Because once you are pointing to something external, you're done. Yeah, it's very good. Yeah, this is a good one. Don't treat anything as a black box and say, you know, I'm just using it. It may work. It may not work tomorrow.
Instead of using a unified version of JS or something like it, see the unified version, see what it's doing.
have to understand it fully.
You can flag it off. If you go through it once for say half an hour, you can flag it off if there is an issue.
Yeah, even if you don't understand it, there is a lot of times that I use code that I never understand, or I think, okay, you know, I'll understand this later. And then later never happens. But I always pull in code first. Keep it with myself. Never link it somewhere else. Because you never know what's happening there.